Okay, Beth said if you need a t-shirt, she'll make you one with that on, right? Well, we had a t-shirt one time at a conference that said, "He that endured to the end gets all the blessings." But, and if you got games coming up in a little while, I guess that means that I need to get out of your way in a hurry, right? My son Rick, he usually is here from Arizona. He was really disappointed that he couldn't come this year. So his ministry there, responsibilities kept him from being able to make the trip over. But he did ask that I say hello to everybody and greet you and give you his greetings and his disappointment that he couldn't be here. He's really bummed out that he didn't get to come. But he's got none of his folks from there are here. And so they're able to say hi for you and represent him. But it's always, you know, it's always great when I get to preach with my son. And our summer Bible conference in July in Chicago, which you're, by the way, you're certainly invited to come to. It's beautiful in Chicago in the summertime. It's pretty in the wintertime too. I tell people, we walk on water in Chicago. We do the impossible. This time of the year, in fact, my wife and I went to the airport Thursday morning to come out here, and I actually drove my car on water. It's ice, 10 degrees. So things kind of freeze over. But in our summer conference, we have four of the men that preach there every year have their sons also preach in our conference. And I got to thinking about it several years ago. I don't think I'd ever been to a Bible conference. We have 26 different speakers during the week. And I don't think, I got to thinking, I didn't think I'd ever been to a conference where you had two or three guys, dads, and their sons are also pastors. You know, one or two, so we had three, and now we have four, and the fourth guy has twin sons, and they both preach.
Wow.
So we have, about twice as many preachers at the meeting as we have places from the preach. So if we would let everybody preach, it'd take about 2.5 weeks to have the meeting. So we don't, everybody doesn't get to preach every year. But it is fascinating to see the godly generations and the fact that there's a great future for the message of grace and the preaching of it, and young men that come along and preach and learn to preach and raise in homes that are dedicated to doing that. And Grace School of the Bible is a shoestring operation. We're not a big operation. We've been doing distance learning since the 80s when we started the school back in the 80s and started doing the video extension ministry. People told me, said, "Oh, that's just extension school," and they poo-pooed it, you know, kind of thing. And in the early 90s, I realized that the future was going to be this kind of thing. And that's what's turned out. Every institution in America today that's going to survive has to have a distance learning program. I have two granddaughters that go to Arizona State University. ASU advertises on the radio in Chicago to get students for distant learning. You can get a degree from ASU in Chicago, never leave Chicago, do it all online. Their grandmother's thinking about joining them as students, undergraduate students at ASU. Her granddaughters are not impressed. But as long as she stays in Chicago, it'll probably be okay. But, you know, every week, we get new applicants. We get from 2 to 5, 6 applications for the school every week. And we don't do any advertising. Mostly, if you're the president of a Bible college or Bible institute, you have two main jobs. One is to enlist students, go out and get students. And two, raise money. And as a president of Grace School of Bible, I don't do either. We don't have any advertising program except our people and the word of mouth, that kind of thing. So, and a number of you folks help us financially and provide the funds for us to carry on. And point students toward us and that kind of thing, train people for the work of the ministry. And we have graduates here. A number of you guys are graduated from the school. And I appreciate that. And it's a real fellowship of ministry to be a part of something together. And I want you to know there are meetings just like this all across America and around the world almost every month. I'd say not almost every month now. And one of my goals years ago was to have a conference like this that believed a gospel you, you know, preach the gospel you can believe, a Bible you can trust, a study you can understand, a life you can live, and a purpose you can fulfill on every continent. Now, we hadn't quite got there yet, but we got four of them. So, you know, how many continents are there?
I mean, we don't know.
You don't know. There's not any time for us to know at all, is it? You're still trying to save the earth.
Somebody asked Siri.
Well, there's seven. And we appreciate the opportunity to do that. And I was in the Philippines last time I was there in 2000. We actually graduated 63 students in one meeting in the Philippines. From Grace School of Bible, and that kind of thing continues to go on too. So it's just, you know, it's an exciting day to me. You know, we talk about the darkness of the day and the difficulty of the time. To me, any time, listen, any era you lived in, the world lies in the lap of wickedness. The god of this world is the adversary, and the world's never been a friend of grace to help you on the God. And so no matter what the cultural things are and that kind of thing, we're talking this afternoon in the Q&A question time about some things about the country, Vance talking about some things in Canada. And I was thinking about it. You know, if you look at the New World, when in the 15th century, when they discovered the New World and began to populate it, South America, the Catholics populated South America, Central America. Canada, it was the French, and it was the British that populated the United States. If you know anything about the French Revolution, you know that the French Revolution was a revolution of nihilism. They burned Bibles, they burned books. But the British Revolution, the Magna Carta, and all that kind of stuff. England was the focal point of the Protestant Reformation. And when they came to the New World, wherever they went, anywhere you go where the British Empire was, you'll find Christianity. You'll find Protestant Christianity. You see the thing yesterday or the day before with the Pope and the Russian Orthodox Patriarch getting together? They split in 1000, right in the middle of the Dark Ages. They busted up. And those two dudes have never talked in those offices until this past week. They meet down in Cuba, of all places. Tells you something about them. And the Metropolitan of the Russian Orthodox Church and the Pope, they're both communists. You know that, politically. You did know that, did you?
Yes.
You didn't know that. Well, you know it now. And they meet down there with Raul, and they talk. Now, they're worried because there's this Muslim invasion of Asia, of Europe again. The hammer, Martel, back in the 13th century, if it hadn't been for him, they'd all be Muslims today. And they beat him back. And Loyola, you know who Loyola was? Loyola University, and he started the Jesuits. He was wounded fighting the Muslim invasion of Europe. He was a Catholic warrior. And he was wounded doing that, and when he couldn't serve in the army anymore, he looked around and he realized that Europe, the Pope was asleep, and Europe had become about 60-70% Protestant in the Protestant Reformation. And he established the Jesuits as a assault army against the Protestants. And the Jesuits were established by the Roman Catholic Church under Loyola for the sole purpose and the stated aim of destroying Protestantism. The American colonies came in, and for all that they did, it was the fruit of the Protestant Reformation. And what you see in America, as opposed to Canada or South America, the rest of the kind of things, is what you see when you're talking about how the world looks at America and the influence of America and American Christianity. It is different than everywhere else, because it was the new ground in a new continent, very special kind of geopolitical area. But it had that. It was the expression of that Protestant faith and the basic consensus of Protestantism. They weren't all hardly any of them knew anything about right division, but they did know some things about the gospel of grace, and there were a lot of them that were real wackos. I mean, it was the Puritans who were burning people at the stake because they didn't agree with them. Mm. There were some other ones that established a state called Maryland. Maryland. Mm-hmm. But they established it because that was a Protestant. That was a Catholic colony. You had to believe there to be a Catholic. They had really, if you go back and read the state charters of those first 13 colonies, they had religious tests. Roger Williams, the Baptist guy, he was thrown out, of some of the things. What am I doing?
It's scratched.
Yeah, it's rubbing.
Yeah, and you raised that higher too, because it raised
Okay. Is that higher? Is that good enough? Does that work?
Put it on the time.
Is it backwards? Turn it over that way. And they don't spare any expenses getting clips of these things, do they? All right, well, the commercial's over with, obviously, now. But anyway, if you want to see the influence, and Justice Scalia died today.
Wow.
He is a devout Roman Catholic. The two people on the Supreme Court, you're either a Roman Catholic or you're a Jewish. There's not anything anywhere close to being a Bible believer. The main religious denomination affiliation in the Congress and the Senate of the United States is Roman Catholic. You guys watch Fox News? Every one of the people in the evening, O'Reilly, what's your name?
Megan.
And Hannity, they're all Roman Catholic. Greta's the only one that didn't. She's Scientologist. Your buddy Glenn Beck, yelling at Donald Trump last week about how dumb it is for him to be a Christian, he's a former Catholic who became a Mormon. And he's telling you Donald's nuts. You go on the other ones, Chris Matthews, all these are Jesuit trained Catholics. Okay? I mean, you gotta think about that. In 1960, when John F. Kennedy, Roman Catholic, was elected President of the United States, prior to that, I mean, even when he was elected, people didn't think a Catholic could get elected. Your forefathers understood some things about that, about the dangers involved in that. And people don't get it now. But the reason America had that shining light was because of the power of the preaching of the gospel that came out of the Protestant Reformation. It's all dumbed down now. And the thing is at the bottom of the change is the loss of that. And when you look at other nations, they didn't have that benefit like we did. Now there's other places in the world that have had it. But when you look at the Americas, that's largely the explanation for that. And you got to understand, folks, what people understand spiritually and outward activity always comes. Every outward activity, I don't care what it is, good, bad, or indifferent, comes from a thinking process inside. No one goes into gross sin without a long process of evil thinking. Yes. And people don't go into godliness without a long process of godly thinking. And I say it again, the amount of sound doctrine resident in the populace of a nation is what determines the course of that nation. You don't have to have, it doesn't have to just be Christians, people don't have to be believers even. But if there's the structure that makes society work, God established nationalism. He set up some principles whereby nations operate. What he set up government, what it's for. If you go by the principles of what a nation is, what government is for, whether your motivation for it is to do it for God or just do it because it's what makes it work, it'll work. Because structure works. Okay? And that's got nothing to do with what I'm talking about. But I should have got started on it. But it's important to understand some of those kind of things in light of what you think about in our country, where we are, and that kind of thing. Because the answer for where you live is going to be taking the pillar and the ground of truth, which is what a local group of believers doing the work of the ministry is designed to be. And John said this afternoon, Christendom is Christendom, isn't that a great, it's like Florida. Christendom, the emphasis is on the dumb part of it. That's the institution. You can build an institution, finance it enough, you can't kill it. But it can go apostate and leave truth. The institution's still there. If you study church history, what you study mainly is the apostate institutions left behind, many of them established by good people, but then turned bad, and you just study their continuous existence. But the true body of Christ is people like you and me. And you can pass along songbooks and buildings and organizations to people, you can't pass along faith. You can't pass along a personal relationship with the God of heaven. That comes only by faith in Christ Jesus personally had. And when you have that life become your life, then you have something that affects things and that makes life. So my topic tonight is the issue of, I gotta read this thing to you, shouldn't I? And these are not short Bible. Can I really know and have a relationship with the God of heaven and earth? Now that's a good question. Because a lot of folks don't think you can. Go back with you. Did I tell you Acts 17? Mm-hmm. We looked at Acts 17 last night, and I want to start there. We'll get to 1 Timothy 2. Acts chapter 17, and go back with me to verse number 16. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. And I talked to you about that in some detail, but I just want to emphasize that thing. He saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Now that issue about being given over to idolatry completely, hold your hand and come with me to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, we looked at the passage last night about how it is that they're given over to idolatry, where idolatry comes from, what it is. I want you to notice three verses, verse 24. Wherefore, because when they knew God, they didn't glorify him as God. They weren't thankful, but they became vain in imaginations. Their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves as wise, they became fools. They changed the glory of God into a lie. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness, to the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. God gave them up. The city was wholly given to idolatry. God literally gave them up to the idolatry that they chose. They didn't want him. He said, there it is. Have what you want. He gave them over to their choice. And by the way, you notice in verse 24, he gave them up to uncleanness, to the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their bodies between themselves. Sexual permissiveness was the first mark of being given up. The inability to conduct themselves in a way between people, and sexual, you know, in our culture, one of the brothers put a thing up here that they're talking about the 60s with the sexual permissiveness. That's a sign of God-given people, of people being given up to idolatry. They changed the truth of God into a lie, worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever, amen. Now verse 26, for this cause God gave them up. The next step, unto vile affections. For even the women did change the natural use that is into that which is against nature, and likewise also the man, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, receiving in themselves the recompense of their error, which is me. Theirs is not sexual permissiveness, their sexual perversion. Going in, just going in a pell-mell, mad rush away from what God created man and woman, his creation, to be. You see, when you leave the institution of marriage, God made four institutions to make society work. Volition, your personal choice to do what he says to do. Two, marriage, one man, one woman for a lifetime. Why? To be the basic social block of culture. Family, for the passing on of values, the passing on of tradition, the educating, the civilizing. Robert Bork years ago wrote a book called Slouching Toward Gomorrah. And in it he said that every year there's a generation of new savages born who need to be civilized by the institutions of society designed to do that, schools, churches, and government. And I thought, wow, that's a great way to say that. Because if you've had kids, and most of us do, you know they come into the world little savages. Now, they're sweet little dudes. But you have to train them. And as you train them, you're teaching, you literally civilize them. You enculturate them. And part of the home is the first place that happens. The church and the schools are places that are designed to enforce what the home does, what the marriage does, what the family does. And then beyond that, in society, there's the nations. And you're seeing those things destroyed here. God gave them up to that. Verse 28, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, they said, I don't want to think about God. We don't want to know about God. We don't hear anything God has to say. God gave them over to a reprobate mind, to do those things which are not convenient. Being filled with all malice, unrighteousness. And look at the list of stuff in verse 28, 29, 30, 32. He says, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. That's the depths of sin. We not only have pleasure in doing them, we're going to demand that you like us doing what we do. And we're not going to let you not like us. We're going to demand that you approve of us. And we're going to have pleasure in them that... And that's just the total destruction of order that God had designed, the institutions God had designed for the orderly maintenance of culture. And when you do that, you just get... You get the violence that government is designed to stop. So what you have in Acts 17 is Paul sees the cultural impact of people given over to idolatry. Now, look down at verse 30. Verse 29. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead, Acts 17, verse 29, that the Godhead, that term Godhead is used three times in the Bible, once in Romans chapter 1. Where everybody knows his eternal power and Godhead. So I'm trying to make the connection to Acts 17 and Romans 1 stick in your mind, okay? We ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone and graven by art and man's devices. You ought not think that the Godhead is like a bunch of idols. Idolatry. And the time of this ignorance, God winked at. So there is a time of ignorance in the Bible, back here among the Gentiles, that God winked at. The Gentiles down here were in ignorance. And he said there's a time of this ignorance that God winked at. I love that thing in Acts 17 when he says, you the unknown God, you're a bunch of ignoramuses. You don't know. That's what ignorant means. And you don't know, and you're too superstitious. If I stood here, if I get on the radio and say things, you know, try to provoke the audience, but you don't want to get thrown off. But you get out and call people a bunch of superstitious ignoramuses. That's not exactly trying to be culturally relevant. I said that to you last night. That's what Paul's doing. He's not trying to insult him, he's making a point about what's going on. Now, you got Acts 17, hold your hand, come back to Acts chapter 14. Acts 14, the time of this ignorance has a title, Acts 14, verse number 15. And Paul says this, "Sirs, why do you these things?" Trying to offer sacrifices to them, because they think that they're Mercury and Jupiter. "We also are men of like passion with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God." The vanities, that's the stuff in Romans 1 about they became vain in their imaginations. What they do? They produce vanities, idolatry. "Turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth, the sea, and all things that are therein, who in times past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways." So back here in time past, God allowed the nations back here in time past to walk in their own ways. During that same time period, he concluded them unbelief, and he brought out a guy by the name of Abraham, and made of Abraham a nation in the earth that was going to be his nation. You with me? Mm-hmm. Ephesians chapter 2. Come there and look at it with me. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. "Wherefore remember that you being in time past, Gentiles in the flesh." He's going to describe the Gentiles at Ephesus back here. In time past, you were Gentiles. In time past, you were down here walking in your own ways in ignorance, having rejected the God of the Bible. Not ignorant because you couldn't know. Ignorant because you didn't want to know. They chose to walk in their own ways. They know God. They don't glorify him as God, neither they're thankful, they became vain in the imagination, etc., etc. That's how the Gentiles got that way. So in time past, Gentiles are in ignorance. Verse number 12, "that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in the world." So God takes the nation Israel up here, the circumcision, makes covenants and promises with these people up here in time past, and there's this separation back here. I said to you last night, in time past, in Israel's program, there was no Gentile evangelism program. That's because the time back here in time past for the Gentile evangelism was in the ages to come. Christ is going to come back over here, sit on the throne in Jerusalem, and out of Jerusalem, the Word of God's going to go, and the time of worldwide Gentile salvation is the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 28, when he says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations," that's the commission that God gives Israel to teach the nations. They don't have a commission to teach the nations until the kingdom. Think about what he says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Is Israel reckoned among the nations?
No.
When he says go teach the nations, he's not talking about go teach Israel. He's talking to Israel to go teach the nations. You say, well, doesn't Israel need to get saved? Not in the kingdom, because when the new covenant comes into effect right there, what does he say? He says he's going to write his law in their hearts. You're not going to need to teach every man his neighbor, saying, "Know the Lord, for they'll all know me from the least to the greatest." Now, you never heard anybody teach you the details of Matthew 28 when they went in a missionary conference trying to raise money for missions. Did you know that the term the Great Commission didn't exist before the mid-1800s? It was developed by a missionary in India. Anybody know who the great British missionary to India was? Oh, you guys. You don't know who Beyonce is? I wouldn't want to be you when I hit the judgment seat of Christ. You know a clown like that, and you don't know who opened up India, changed the whole Indian nation for the gospel in the 1800s. You got some studying to do when you get home. You ought to know your family history. But in order to raise money for missions, he went all over the world, all over the British Empire, raising money, and he developed the term, the Great Commission. Google it. You'll find it on Google. You'll find Lutherans hate the term. They got articles written against it. Do you know that? People say, you guys don't believe the Great Commission? Let's hold on, folks, I don't. Because they know where it came from. It's a catchphrase used by missionaries to raise money for missions. Now, I'm not opposed to raising money for missions. I'm happy to see money go into missions and so forth. But my point is that that's why people don't teach you the details of it. Matthew 28, Mark 16, Luke 24, John 20, and Acts 1. You don't hear the details of that because they all fit this. Here's the time of Gentile world salvation. Back here, he's gathering together the nation who's going to do it over here. Now, back to verse number 17, chapter 7, Acts 17. That, and the time of this ignorance God winked at. So back here, Paul is saying, now, see what the rest of that verse says? But now commands all men everywhere to do what? Now who gets, now who's the message for?
Everybody.
Everybody. By the way, Paul did the time past but now thing way before Acts chapter, Ephesians chapter 2. Hello. The reason that timeline is so effective is it just lays out the scripture using Paul's terminology. But that wasn't the first time he ever thought about that terminology. He understood what time past was. Gentiles walk in their ignorance. God had given them up to idolatry, raised up his nation to be his representative in the earth, committed his truth to them. Then there came a point where the fall of Israel took place. Christ dies on the cross, ascends into heaven, Holy Spirit comes here, book of Acts, and then the fall of Israel, Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter number 11. The question is, can you really have a relationship with the God of heaven? In time past, you didn't. You're a bunch of Gentiles. Now, there may be a Jewish person here tonight. I don't know. In my assembly in Chicago, sure, but we have three Jewish believers. In a church of 200 people, that's a big percentage, frankly.
Yeah.
A lot of, you know, I say that to people sometimes. I get mail. Someone says, you got three Jewish believers in your church? Wow. You know, like it's something big thing. Well, it's a big thing. But we got a lot of Polish believers, and we got a lot of African American believers, and we got a lot of Filipino believers, and we got Korean believers, and we got Kenyan believers, and we got Italian. You know, when I moved to Chicago, I'm from Alabama. I didn't know there was but two people in the world, two kind of people, white folks and black folks. You live in Alabama, that's all you ever see. White people, black people, that's all there was. I moved to Chicago and I realized there's about 50 different kind of white people. There's so many different kind of white people. And a lot of them don't like each other. He's like, well, you don't like me because of my... Listen, he's like, don't like me because of the color of my skin. Listen, I know white folks don't like other white folks. You take a Norwegian and a Scandinavian. One spells it Anderson and it spells it Anderson. Uh-huh, see there? And you better not mess it up. You take a Bosnian and a Serbian. You never seen people get mad at each other until you've seen them sit at the table together. In fact, they won't sit at the table together. You can't hardly get in the same room together. Then you get a Greek and a Pole. I almost said it, didn't I? We have a bunch of Polish people in our assembly, and they call themselves Polaks. But if I say it, I'm in trouble. Wonderful people. But then they sit over here with the Italians. Italians. They say, don't say Italian, but Italian. I'm trying to learn. I'm just slow. And they sort of, and these people have cultural thinking differences. Now, I said, they all look the same. They all look the same to me. I didn't realize there's that many different people. But they're different. And that's a normal kind of thing in the world. You know what? You go to places all over the world. I've been on several different continents and seen people that all look the same to me, and among themselves, they didn't look the same. Went to the Philippines. And I discovered that some folks on one island didn't like the folks on the other island. I thought they were all Filipinos to me, and they were. But then when they looked at each other, they thought they saw different things, you know. Well, that's normal. That's the way life is. That's sort of a spice of the variety of life. But you know where we all are? right down here. One nation. But now, he commands all men, not some men, all men. He changed the program. Romans 11:11. I say that if they stumble, they should fall. That's Israel. God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles, should have provoked them to jealousy. So through the fall of Israel, not the rise of Israel into the glory of that kingdom so that the Gentiles would come to the brightness of the rising, but through the fall of Israel, down here to the position of ignorance and unbelief. Verse 30. Romans 11:30. For as ye in time past have not believed God, back here, you Gentiles didn't believe God, yet now have obtained mercy through their unbelief, for God hath included them in unbelief that he might have mercy upon all. I start verse 30 again, so I skip 31. For as ye in time past have not believed God, yet now have obtained mercy through their, Israel's unbelief, even so have these also now not believed that through your mercy, they may obtain mercy. In other words, God set them aside over here, so instead of pouring out wrath on them over here and the tribulation wrath, he set them aside and showed mercy to a bunch of unbelievers down here, put them down here with the unbelievers so he could have mercy on everybody, form a church, the body of Christ, out of Jew, Gentile, bond or free, no distinction, no difference between them. And now he can have mercy on everybody. So now everybody has the opportunity to know the God of heaven. And I say that to you because, look, if you're going to be studying in your Bible, you're going to go back here in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you don't have an everyman ministry. Mm-hmm. If you go over here to Hebrews, to Revelation, you don't have an everyman ministry. It's in Romans through Philemon that you're going to find this everyman ministry. Come with me to Matthew 20 in one hand and 1 Timothy. Matthew chapter 20 and 1 Timothy. If you can't write or divide your Bible, you're not going to have a gospel message to preach to anybody. 1 Timothy chapter 2. Verse number 4. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 3. For this is good and acceptable in sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So the will of God today in the dispensation of grace is that everybody would be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. You want to do the will of God today? This is not brain surgery. You want to know what God's will for your life is? Somebody says to me, Brother Rick, I want to know, does God want me to marry so-and-so? I got no idea, neither does he. He didn't have a preference. The only thing God says about who you marry is they have to be in the Lord. They got to be saved. Now, there's a bunch of other criteria you need to check out than just that they're saved. There's some compatibility issues and there's some things of that nature, but God says the first requirement for you to marry is to be saved. They got to be saved. If they aren't saved, mark them off the list. Okay? The will of God is that everybody be saved. That's God's will. God's will is revealed in His Word. You see, we think about the will of God, we think, where does He want me to be at 3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon? I need to, you know, the guy down in Georgia, he says, you need to read the signpost. You know, God puts signposts along the way. That's not in a fruitcake. That particular guy, there's signposts in the Word of God that say that if a man's going to be the pastor of a church, he's to be the husband of one wife. Did you know that guy can't qualify for that? Oh. Gee, isn't that interesting? If he doesn't qualify according to the verse, why would you make him the pastor of the church? Would it be the will of God that he be the pastor of the church if he doesn't do what the will of God in the Word of God says a pastor ought to be? The answer is no. I mentioned that dude last night from up in Seattle that was the pastor of that big church, got closed down because he got disqualified from the pulpit. He moved to Phoenix and still calls himself a pastor. I wrote him an email. I said, Mark, how do you still call yourself a pastor when you disqualified yourself in 1 Timothy chapter 3 from being a pastor? He wrote me back. He wrote me back when I bought his book, but he didn't write me back with that. Well, you don't know the will of God. The Word of God tells you what the will of God is. You get into God's Word, find out what God's doing, and do that, and you will be doing the will of God. That's simple. If you will do by faith what God says He's doing, you'll be doing by definition the will of God. And you won't be, so you won't have to be running around. You see, you run around wanting to be about you. It's not about you. It's about what He's doing.
That's right.
And what He's doing, and what you're doing in what He's doing. Your participation in that. That's why understanding where it is in the Word of God, to understand what God's doing today, is so critically important, because you can't do the... Look, you go back in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you're never going to be big enough a day in your life to make God do something He's not doing. You can claim these verses all you want to, and if it's not what He's doing, you're not going to make any difference in it. So if you don't know what God's doing in His Word, where He tells you what He's doing, then you're going to just be lost. You're spinning your wheels. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4. First thing, God have you be saved. Second, come the knowledge of the truth. That's what all this study is about. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave Himself a ransom for what?
All.
All to be testified, notice, in due time. The Apostle Paul is the due time testifier of the fact that God gave His Son to be a ransom for all. But now He commands all men. Now it's an every man ministry. Everybody's in unbelief, that everybody can be saved. Whereunto, the next verse says, I was appointed a preacher and a teacher and apostle of the Gentiles in faith and verity. The reason Paul was made an apostle was so he could be the due time testifier of the fact that now God commands all men to be, to repent, to believe. Follow that? Compare it with Matthew 20. Hold on there and compare it with Matthew 20. Matthew 20, 28. Jesus says, even as the Son of Man came to be ministered unto, not to be ministered unto, but to minister and give His life a ransom for all.
Nope.
Many. See, that verse didn't say He gave Himself a ransom for all. It said He gave Himself a ransom for many. Now, many is a lot, but many ain't all. That's the verse that the Calvinists come along and say, well, see, Jesus didn't die for everybody. Now, let's go by the book. Let's believe it literally. Now, they don't believe hardly anything literally, but the verses like that, they like literally. He didn't say all, He said many. That's just the elect. Well, that many is Israel. And you know who Israel is in the Bible? They are the elect. And that's how you break your neck on a theological knot that you could have not had if you knew something about right division. They don't know anything about right division. They reject right division because it destroys their system of philosophical speculation, and they like that rather, and they'd rather just break their fool neck back over here getting their own way. Back here, He gave Himself a ransom for many. Isaiah 53, who does He say? What He said? Isaiah says, look back at Isaiah 53. We love that passage. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone in our own way, and the Lord has laid upon Him the iniquity of us all. I used to work at the rescue mission years ago. Many times we'd tell people, say, you come at the first all we like sheep have gone astray, and you come out at the last all. He laid His iniquity, the iniquity of us all, iniquity of us all. Come at the first all, you're lost. Go out at the last all, you're saved. But the problem with that is, if you go down to verse number 8, at the end of the verse, He says, for the transgression of My people was He stricken. Who did Isaiah think He died for?
His people.
The angel told Joseph, He says, thou shalt call His name Jesus, for He shall save His people. People that already were His from their sins. That's Israel. He's Israel's Redeemer. Israel's, these dudes down here in ignorance didn't care anything about it. And the redemption, the ransom was for them. But now, that dispensational change from time past to but now is real important. So the first thing you have to decide is, can I really know and have a relationship with the God of heaven and earth, the creator of all things? The first thing you got to know is, yes, you can, because God changed the program from back here to over here. Don't go back over here to try to find your relationship. It's going to be in here. And the reason people have struggles in having a personal relationship with God today through Jesus Christ is they're trying to find it back here where they aren't. People get saved by grace, hear the gospel. Christ died for their sins, was buried, rose again the third day, and they believe the gospel, and they hear that, and then they go back here trying to find themselves. They got saved, but the whole Christian life's a frustrated mess where they're trying to perform and do these things. Wednesday was Lent. First day of Lent, Ash Wednesday. I didn't realize it. I was watching TV. And I was watching a news show, and there's this commentator with a black thing on his forehead. And I'm looking, I said, what? Oh, yesterday was Mardi Gras. Today's Fat Tuesday, today's Lent. And I got to watch it, and I watched Fox News, and I watched MSNBC, and I watched CNN. My wife gets so mad at me when I watch CNN. And I watched the American News Network, which is probably the best of the bunch of them. And I'm watching, that's the only station I didn't see the little black dot. And then I'm watching some of these guys that I know are Catholics and they didn't have the black dot. And I'm thinking, they must have had the forehead washed before they went to work today. Why do you do that? What's the intent of Lent? I'm going to give up some stuff, make God happy with me, get a little closer to Him because I gave it up. You know what that is? That's a good program right back there, good program right over here. That's heresy in here. Nearer to God, nearer I cannot be, for in the person of His Son, I'm as near as He. Dearer to God, dearer I cannot be, for with the love He has for His Son is the very love He has for me. I'm accepted in the Beloved. I'm not accepted on the basis of what I do. Don't do. I'm complete in Him. Everything God has for me, I have in Him. My task now, listen, if you've got everything God gave you up front in Christ that instant, the only thing left for you to do is to know about it, figure it out, find out about it, and then appropriate it by faith into your life when you need it.
Amen.
Okay? Faith is the only thing you can do without doing something. Just taking God at His word. So when you come to 1 Timothy 2, you say, okay, now I can have a relationship. Now I can know it. Now you know what notice what he says in verse number. I'll say it one more time. It's critical for you to understand either to get. Look, if you go back in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they don't even know the Lord Jesus Christ is going to die. Luke 18, 31 to 34, when he began to tell them he's going to go die and be resurrected the third day, the text says they don't understand what he said. They didn't understand it when he told Peter that in John in Mark 6, in Matthew 16. He said, Lord, there's nobody going to lay a hand on you. They got to get through me first. And when they came to get him in the garden, what did Pete do? He pulled out his sword, tried to cut the dude's head off. The dude ducked and just got his ear. But you don't, how do you get a guy's ear with a sword?
Going for the head.
You're going for his head and he ducks. It's on, if you hit him like that, you get his shoulder. Peter was a commercial fisherman, folks. Any of you ever known a commercial fisherman? There are two or three breeds in the world in commerce that are just meaner than snakes and tougher than junkyard dogs. Commercial fishermen's one of them. I was raised on the Gulf Coast. I got relatives of commercial fishermen. And the idea of fighting, why, I'll fight at the drop of the hat, and if you're not fast enough, I'll drop the hat. The idea that Peter's gonna stick up for the Lord, you know what screwed Peter up? Confused him? The words are, put up your sword, Peter. I'm going to surrender. Now, when you're ready to fight and die for somebody, and they just give up without a fight. Pete wasn't a coward. Pilate was the coward. Peter was confused. He wasn't ready for the Lord to surrender. He had no idea he's going to the cross to die for his sins. That's my point. So if you go back here in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John looking for the gospel of the grace of God, you're in trouble. You can't find it with a flashlight. You take a stick of dynamite and blow the books apart, you can't find it. It isn't out there. Now, there's a gospel, but it's not the gospel of the grace of God. People say, well, there's only one gospel in the Bible. But what, you fell out of a tree on your head and hadn't woken up yet. You say, well, my preacher, I don't care what your preacher said. What, let me tell you what he meant to say. He meant to say that today there's only one gospel. But when he said there's only one gospel in the Bible, a six-year-old kid that flunked kindergarten knows better than that if he just reads. He said, well, my preacher's been, he's a college graduate, got a seminary degree, can read Greek and Hebrew. Listen, I don't care if he can jump over the moon. You can't find that back there in the text. You find it in your tradition, you find it in your confessions, you find it in your doctrinal statements, but you don't find it in the Bible. That's why people don't go about the Bible. That's why they don't care if you change the Bible. Don't mess with my doctrinal statement. Forget about it. Change the Bible all you want to. Because where do we get our doctrine? Out of the doctrinal statement. It's infallible. And the book I'm supposed to get it out of, well, you know, do whatever you want to with it. And then somebody like us comes along and says, no, it's the book that's infallible. Your doctrinal statement has to fit that. Not. And they say, oh, you guys are just a bunch of radicals. They had a quote from Scalia on the news this evening. He said, I'm a strict constructionist. I'm not a nut. People call him a nut. We're Bible believers. We're not nuts. Festus looked at Paul and says, much learning has made me mad. That's where the world looks at you. You're nuts. Now you know better. But you can be a Bible believer and get yourself in trouble if you don't rightly divide it. Here's where our message is. That's where our gospel is. And that's where your life is. That's where you come to know the truth. You know why your Christian life can be a frustration to you? Name any part of it. Your giving, your praying, you worry about your kids. Christians worry about, you know, they worry about sin in their life. They worry about not pleasing God. They worry about the raising of kids. All the things you worry about in life. If you're trying to get answers over here, you can wind up in confusion. The answers are here, and you need to know why. You can have a relationship, but you're going to have it through His Word, rightly divided. That's my point. Okay? Verse number 5. There's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. There's one mediator, one go-between. The mediator is not angels. Look at Colossians chapter 2. People are always looking for some kind of supernatural intervention. Colossians 2 verse 18, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. People are looking for this angelic intervention. We sing that song, angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. We don't sing that in our church. But we like blessed assurance, so we change those words. Because we don't have angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. You know what we got? We got a book. We don't have angels coming down out of the sky. The mediator between you and God is not some supernatural creature, an angel, or an angelic intervention. You see what that verse says, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up in his fleshly mind. You have never seen an angel. Now, don't get mad at me, ladies. If your husband tells you you're an angel, don't say, Brother Rick said you never saw an angel. Outside of your wife. But I'm talking about angels in the Bible. The mediator is not angel. The mediator and dead saints. Come with me to the book of Job, chapter 5. You go up here to the end of Capistrano, Camino Capistrano, and you'll find there's a mission up there in San Juan Capistrano where the swallows come back in March. And you go into that mission, and there's a little functional chapel in there, and there's all kind of saints in there for you to pray for, have novenas with, do all that kind of stuff. Let me tell you something. Dead saints in the Bible don't do anything for you. Book of Job, the oldest book in the Bible ever written, got a guy, he's talking to Job, and when Eliphaz talks, he says in chapter 5, verse 1, call now if there be any that will answer thee. Pray and ask, see if somebody will answer. And to which of the saints wilt thou turn? He said, Job, go find answers. Pray to the saints. But notice the saints that he's talking about. Chapter 4, verse 18. Behold, he put no trust in his servants, and his angels he charged with folly, much less in them that dwell in houses of clay, whose foundation is in the dust, which are crushed before the moth. They are destroyed from the morning to the evening. They perish forever without any regarding it. Doth not their excellency, which is in them, go away? They die even without wisdom. Call if thou wilt. He's talking about dead saints. And he says, you pray to the dead saints and they don't do you any good, because they're not the mediator between God and men. Come with me to Jeremiah 44. The Queen of Heaven isn't the mediator between God and men. You come to where I live in Chicago, where our church building is, not too very far from us. The Queen of Heaven has a church called the Queen of Heaven Church. Certain denomination. That Queen of Heaven that they worship, they worshipped in Paul's day, in Acts 19, the Temple of Diana. That's why he tells Timothy that you're the church of the living God at Ephesus. There was a church of a dead god that worshipped the Queen of Heaven. Her name was Diana then. Her name is Mary today. Back in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 44, Israel had been plagued with her. Jeremiah chapter 44, verse number 15. Jeremiah 44:15. Then all the men which knew that their wives had burned incense unto other gods, and all the women that stood by and a great multitude, even all the people that dwelt in the land of Egypt and Pathros, answered Jeremiah, saying, as for the word that thou hast spoken unto us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto thee. I don't care what the Bible says, we'll go by tradition. But we will certainly do whatever goeth forth out of our mouth, own mouth, to burn incense unto the Queen of Heaven, and to pour out drink offerings unto her. You know what we're going to do? We're going to pray, burn incense to the Queen of Heaven. We're going to pour out drink offerings to her. Verse number 18. But since we left off to burn incense to the Queen of Heaven and to pour out drink offerings unto her, verse 19, we burned incense unto the Queen of Heaven, poured out drink offerings unto her, and we did make cakes to worship her. You know what they're doing? They're having a mass and a Eucharist, where they take a little wafer, hold it up, say, this is your Savior, and they have a little jigger here, and they got the hooch in it, and they bless it like Cain did, and they'll turn it to blood, and they're worshiping the Queen of Heaven while they do it. And the Bible is called Baal worship. It goes all the way back to Genesis chapter number 11, right here where he gave the Gentiles up to walk in their own stupidity. That's part of the religious stupidity the Gentiles walked in. It corrupted Israel. Listen, that's not the mediator. The mediator is not a priesthood. He tells the psalmist, he says, one man can't give a ransom for another. Listen, how's a priest going to give any ransom for you when he can't ransom himself? There's one mediator, the man, Christ Jesus. God became man. The Word became flesh. He's God, he can hold God by the hand, he can hold man by the hand, and he can bring us together in a mediator. He's the one. And how did he do it? He went to Calvary. God made him to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He gave his life a ransom for many. The guy sang a song a minute ago, Man of Sorrows, you call that? There's a hymn. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah! What a Savior. I mean, that's who he is. He's the mediator. And the way you have a relationship with him is to him that works not, but believes on him that justifies the ungodly. His faith is counted for righteousness. The way you have a relationship with him is you, by faith, rest upon him and who he is and what he's done for you. And you rest on him to get saved, and you rest on him for your Christian life. We walk by, we walk Christian life, not by sight, but by faith. Not by what we're looking at. Are you so foolish? Having begun in the spirit, are you now made perfect through the flesh? No. What happens? God saves you, puts you in Christ. How do you do that? By faith in Christ. When you trust Him, you rely exclusively on Him. God takes you out of Adam, out of who you are in yourself, and puts you into the Lord Jesus Christ, and there He blesses you with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, makes you complete in Him. Everything you will ever need from God, you have. You talk about a fulfilled life. Everybody's trying to have fulfillment. Purpose, meaning, validation, acceptance, and all that kind of stuff that we strive for. He said, you never get it anywhere but in Jesus Christ. And I give it to you free for nothing because He paid for it. Free to you, expensive to Him. You get that? It's not cheap. Grace, nothing cheap about grace. If it costs God the blood of His own Son, don't say it's cheap. He gives it to you. He pays it and gives it to you. This is Valentine's weekend. I'm not a Hallmark fan. I don't do the Hallmark holidays. We're down at the store the other day, and all these guys buying flowers, you know. If you come to Chicago and you go through the airport, you watch people buy Garrett's popcorn, caramel corn, and I'll sit down next to somebody with a thing. I said, peace offering, right? Taking it home. I do the same thing. I take it on peace offering. And you don't give her a gift and say, sugar, I love you. By the way, I charge it on your charge card. You pay for it. It doesn't cost you anything. Somebody gives you a gift, you don't say, what can I pay for? See, I buy it. I pay for it. He bought it. He paid for it with the blood of His own Son. He gives it to you. You know why He gives it to you free? Because you didn't have anything you could pay. Now listen to me. You don't have any more after you get saved than you had before you get saved to pay. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but by His mercy He saved us. But let me tell you something. Now you go out and do some works of righteousness. The problem with your works of righteousness is they aren't perfect. In that verse in Isaiah, He says all of our righteousnesses were as filthy rags. He didn't say you didn't do righteousness. He said you did some. The problem that you did is when you compare them to Him, you come short of His glory. His glory is He never made a mistake. The law says you have to fulfill, you have to do all the things. Now you got a problem. You hadn't done all the things. You're not perfect. That's what sin is. That's why you don't go to heaven on your own. Because you don't deserve it. Didn't say you didn't do some good things. It said you didn't do it perfectly. All the time. Never anything else. James says if you keep the whole law, defend at one point, you're guilty of all. See? The problem isn't that you couldn't. The problem is you didn't. So your good works don't help you because you're still behind. If you didn't sin again from now to the time you died, what are you going to do about the past? Yeah. I mean, you've got a past, dude. What are you going to do about that? You say, well, Lord, I just spent, hell won't be quite as hot for me. Mark Twain said you go to heaven for the environment and you go to hell for the company. Well, you heard in the first session, the company ain't going to be so great. Mark ought to know. One mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave Himself a ransom to be testified in due time, whereof I'm appointed a preacher, a teacher, and an apostle to Gentiles in faith and verity. That's what Paul's ministry is about. To tell you, yeah, you can't have a personal relationship with the God of heaven and earth. You can have it simply by trusting Him. And when you trust Him, He takes your sin, your failure. And can I say this to you? You can't out-sin the grace of God. Where sin abounds, grace did much more abound. I talk to people all the time who believe that they're so bad, God couldn't love them. One of the heartaches of being a pastor is you hear a lot of the underside of things. A little 13-year-old girl comes and says, God couldn't love me. You say, why? She said, I'm just so wicked, I'm so terrible, God could. Now what can you do when you're 13 years old to think that? So you discover that her mom turned up, she was pregnant. Just found out she was pregnant. And the little girl says, she's mad at her mom. She didn't want her mom to be happy. She says, oh, I just hope she didn't have that baby. I hope she didn't have that baby. Because I mean, next week, mom lost the baby. Now the little girl's convinced that the reason she lost the baby is because she asked God to love her mom, have that baby. And she carries that weight around in her from the time she's about 11 years old to the time she's about 14 years old. And it weights her down, and when you sit and talk with her about God commended his love toward us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, she says, but you don't know what I do. That little girl could sit in a meeting just like this and look just like you. And that heartache. A little 6-year-old girl comes and sits in my office and sits down in the chair. Can I talk to you? Closes the door. Sits down in the chair, crosses her legs, and straightens her little skirt out. And she looks at me. And she says, this divorce talk is breaking my heart. 6 years old. You know why she thinks her mom and dad are talking about divorce? She thinks she's the reason. And she carries it around with her for the next 10 years. And it eats at her heart. Then somebody says, God loves you, Christ died for you. And she says, no, he can never die for me. You don't know how bad I am. You don't know what I've done. But the verse said, but you don't know. Then you meet somebody who's been out in the world in wickedness and real sin, bad sin. Well, you meet somebody like I was. I'm 68 years old, never smoked a cigarette in my life, never drunk alcohol, liquor, wine, beer, never did any of that kind of stuff. My wife and I, we got married when we were, she was, she just turned 18, she, 8, 19, I'm sorry, 8 days and 19, she's 19, 8 days. We got married. I have to confess, I did kiss somebody before I married her, but I hadn't kissed anybody since I married her. Well, actually, before we got married. And, I mean, we've been faithful to one another all these years. Never been out running the streets, none of that kind of stuff. And yet there came a time when I realized I was lost. And I realized I couldn't do anything that was going to make me acceptable to God. And I thought I was hopeless. Because I'd done everything you can do to be right and realized I was still lost. I'm just trying to say, from every parameter, that's still the answer. You can't have a personal relationship with the God of heaven and earth through his Son, Lord Jesus Christ. You can know him. And I don't mean just know about him. John 17:3 says, this is eternal life, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. That word know there is not just, hi, I know Joe. first time it shows up in the Bible is Genesis chapter 4. Adam knew his wife Eve, and they conceived and had a son. He's talking about a personal, intimate relationship, knowledge. The word intimate, I love that word. It means into me see. Where I can look into God, he looks into me, and we know one another in a very personal, intimate relationship. And we know one another. You can have that kind of relationship with the God of heaven, but you'll never have it with what you do, trusting what you're accomplishing, looking to your emotions, looking to your accomplishments. You have it one way, by abandoning all of that and putting your faith in what God did for you in Jesus Christ and saying, he's enough. In evil, long I took delight, unawed by shame or fear, until a new object caught my sight and stopped my wild career. I saw one hanging on a tree in agony and blood. He fixed his languid eyes on me as near his cross I stood. My conscience felt and owned the guilt and plunged me in despair. I saw my sins his blood had spilled. My sins had nailed him there. A second look he gave, which said, I freely offer give this blood for thy ransom paid. I died that you might live. Listen. Thus while his death my sin displays in all its blackest hue, such is the mystery of grace. It seals my pardon too. That's how you have a relationship with the God of heaven. This afternoon we were talking, people were talking about motivation for service. And service is acceptable God in heaven. You know what I've learned about motivation? Whatever you do, word or deed, do all the glory of God. Whatever you do, do it in the name of Jesus. You ought to do it for the Lord, not for yourself. But you know, an old preacher said, the closer you get to the light, the better you see the dirt. The closer you get to the Lord, the more you see. I can't trust even my motivation. Because when did ever your motivation be completely pure? You said, what am I doing? I can't trust my own motivation. You run to Calvary. And you say, Lord, it's not I, it's Christ. That's what growth in the Christian life is. It's not running up the flagpole and getting an A on a doctrinal statement or some kind of curriculum. It's not I, but Christ. It's realizing it's not me, it's Him. And at whatever level you are in your spiritual growth, that's how you get to the next level. It's not me. It's Him. So when you go through those points and you get close and you see, then all of a sudden you're looking and you see the dirt. And you say, Lord, I thought I was doing it just for you. And look at here, I see me in there. And you run to Calvary. And you say, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. It's not I, it's Christ. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I sat across the table in Bulgaria, Sofia, Bulgaria, the capital of Bulgaria, from the man who was the number two man in the Bulgarian government for the, I guess now we call it information technology division. Name was Costa. Sat across the table from him and his wife. Had the opportunity to share the gospel with him. He listened intently. He was a man who'd been a communist all of his life. The communist government had fallen. He said, I never gave much thought about God. Don't know if there's a God or not. Willing to listen. And I shared the gospel with him. Got down to the end of it, and he said, you know, that's very interesting, but I just can't, if there's a God, I can't understand why he would think about me. He's busy running the universe. Why would he think of me? Yeah, why would he think of you? But he did. He loved me also and gave himself for me. You want to have a relationship with him? Remember, he loved me. You gave himself for you. The only time I've ever been, never been in a real fist fight, but the only time I was ever hit in the face with a fist was back in the 60s. I was working at the rescue mission in Mobile, and there was a guy, Bill Brusso was his name. He was a captain of a snapper boat. Starfish and Oyster Company out of Mobile had snapper boats, and they'd send them out in the Gulf catch red snapper. And the way they did it is they'd fill the boat up with rum. And as long as the booze was there, the guys would go out in the boat, drink the booze up, and they'd catch snapper, and when the booze had run out, they'd come in. And that was the routine. And Bill, that's what his job was. He'd count. And one of those trips, he got hurt. He broke his arm. And I can't work. So he wound up right at the mission, living in one of the apartments there while he was recovering. Well, if you lived at the mission, you had to go to church. You had to go to the meetings in the morning, 11 o'clock, for the gospel meeting, which I preach most every day. And then in the evening, you had to go to the evening meeting. So he's in church twice a day, and he hadn't been in church twice in his life. And he didn't like it. And I just kept sharing the gospel with him. He kept listening, and he kept hearing it. One day, I hear a knock on my door, my apartment. I open it up, and all I saw was this big fist coming right at my stomach. And he hit me right dead in the chops. Knocked me over. I hit the floor, slid up underneath my bed. And I'm like 19 years old, so I weighed about 140 pounds. And nothing like I do now. That's before I got married. This is my wife's handiwork. And I crawled out from under that bed, and I looked at him, and I said, Bill, why don't you just go in and get saved? Don't save missing teeth. We went downstairs. He's waiting in the office downstairs for me. He was all under terrible conviction. And I said, Bill, I want you to do something. I didn't yell at him. I understood what it was. And I said, I want you to sit there, and I've made him learn verses. And I said, I want you to quote me John 3:16. But when it says, whosoever, I want you to say Bill Brusso. God so loved Bill Brusso that God so loved the world, Bill Brusso, what's the rest of it? That every time you hear Bill Brusso, you hear that? Might not perish, but that Bill might have everlasting life. Got to the end of that, and I have to say, through tears in a man's eyes who probably hadn't cried since he was a baby, he looked at me and he says, I got it, Rick. I got it. And he got saved. The last time I saw Bill Brusso, he was loading up an old, beat-up old Chevrolet car with a bunch of his possessions, had a mattress strapped on the top. He was from Guatemala, and he was on his way back to Guatemala to take the gospel to his family. The last time I heard from him was about 10 years after that. He'd gone to Guatemala and started a church preaching the gospel. And that little gospel church down there. He had him a chalkboard, and he was teaching the Bible and the grace message. It all started God so loved Bill Broussard. He loved me and gave himself for me. That's how you have a relationship with God. As you've received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk you in. It doesn't change after you get saved. You think it does because now you think you've got to show him what a good deal he got when he got you. He didn't get a good deal when he got you. He gave you a good deal. Good deal with his son. And it's still all about his son. So instead of scrutinizing yourself, scrutinize him. That make sense? You can't have a personal relationship. If you haven't ever trusted him, you can. And if you have trusted him and you do have a personal relationship, take it personally. Father, we thank you tonight for life in Christ Jesus. And we thank you that he's enough.
All right, everyone. Thanks.